morning, ladies and gentlemen. My colleague here, Professor Ricolobo, and myself would like to open this session. And it gives me a great pleasure to introduce Professor Misono, whom I had the pleasure of knowing for quite a few years. I met him when he was a postdoc in Tokyo University with Professor Yoneda. And at that time, I said to Professor Misono, at that time he's still a postdoc, I said, "You are going to be the new chairman of this department." He said, no, that's not it. But of course, he became the chairman of this department. That was the University of Tokyo. And you can see how young we are. So he has already now, in Japan, they have to retire early, but he has gotten a new, very important position, and he is at the National Institute of Technology and Evaluation in Tokyo, doing outstanding work like he always did. And his topic today is green catalytic technology, recent developments of heteropolic acid and perovskite catalysts. Professor Misono.
Thank you, Bob. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It is my great honor and pleasure to be able to present a lecture at this very prestigious conference dedicated to the centennial anniversary of the birth of Karimichi Prescott. He was a big name when I started the research on mixed oxide catalysts. Almost half a century ago. I wish to thank Professor Palmo and Professor Ano and other members of the organizing committee for inviting me to this important conference. My talk this morning is about green catalytic technology, recent development of heteropolyacid acid and perovskite catalysts. Let me first explain why I chose green catalytic technology for the subject of my lecture. I think it's time to think about the next 100 years of catalysis. A few years ago, International Assembly of Science Council all over the world discussed and made an important statement about the relationship between the science and the society, and they declared the science for the society is now very important and will be more important in the future, that we science community should demonstrate how useful science is, and that's the reason we are supported by the taxpayers. As for the catalytic science and technology, are we doing pretty well for the society? Are we providing good practical catalysts needed by the society? Are fundamental studies useful enough or helpful enough to develop good catalysts needed by the society? Those are the questions directed to us by the society. I think green catalytic technology is one of the possible answers to the question. So let me explain very briefly what is green chemistry. Green chemistry is in a world environmentally friendly chemical technology and is necessary for the sustainability of the society by two reasons. One is obviously there is a limit of massive growth of human activities. And the other one is the anxiety about the safety of chemical substances are now quite spread in the society. We need to answer those questions. And aims, I think there are three aims of green chemistry. perception of environmental impact and chemical risks caused by chemical technology in very economic and efficient ways. The last thing I think is important to establish good and sound relationship between the chemical community and the general public. Basic concept of green chemistry is expressed, for example, by this basic equation. Environmental impact and all chemical risks can be expressed by this equation. This equation always holds since those are cancelled out. This will increase further, and this is gross domestic product divided by operation, that is, in short, about the living standard. Those two terms will increase in the future, particularly in the developing countries. So in order to suppress the increase of this environmental impact for chemical risks, we need significantly decrease this part. That is, those environmental impact and chemical risks for the unit of economic or human activities. That is the basic concept of green chemistry. And this is expressed in another way. This is so-called environmental business card. This is a very old idea in economy, but recently applied to the economic environmental issues. As the living standard increase or economic activity increase, those two terms generally increase concurrently. But we need to make a U-turn to make the direction of the opposite way. The developed countries are now trying hard to change the direction to some success. But as an example, CO2 emission is hard to reduce. But developed countries are now following developed countries. This is their right. But if they follow the developed countries, then our society cannot survive. So we need to cooperate or collaborate to change, to move to the downslope of this curve. That is another expression of the basic idea of green chemistry. Now, before the term green chemistry is used, there are many good examples in the world. I'll show you two examples from Japan. The first example is the BOD from paper and pulp industry, that is organic pollutants released to the river. In 1970, we have this amount. This is 3 million tons, almost 4 million tons. And most of our from industry, and half of it is from paper and pulp. But after about 20 years, this amount decreased dramatically, mainly due to the effort of the industry. That means paper and pulp industry decreased emission very much. According to the examination made by my friend, this reduction is mainly due to the change of the chemical processes and the raw materials. Only a small portion is due to the treatment of wastewater. This is a very good example of green chemistry. Not to treat the pollutant, but to reuse chemical processes and raw materials which do not emit pollutants. Another example is a well-known electrolysis of sodium chloride using ion exchange membrane that doesn't use mercury. But as for the catalytic technology, there are two roles, I think. One is green processes for chemical conversion to utilize very efficiently resources and energy. And the other is environmental catalyst, which pollutes the polluter. As an example of this category, I'll explain what we have done recently concerning heterophorous catalyst. And for the second category, I'll explain example of peroxide catalyst. for automobile emissions. We have been studying rational design of the practical based on mixed oxide, of which the structure can be well characterized, and heterochloroacetic and peroxide are the examples. First, I will explain what was done in practical application in the field of heterochloroacetic catalysis for green tech processes. As you know, heterochloroacetic can characterize in the solid state by this molecule called the polyamide. As for solid heterochloroacetic in the solid state, we have done many fundamental studies, and some of you may not be familiar with that. I will briefly explain what we have done. First, we found that the heterochloroacetic in the solid state has hierarchical structure. That is primary structure, that is a heterochloroamine, and the secondary structure is ionic crystals made of heterochloroamines and cations. And the tertiary structure is the signs of primary pass-through or it's the way of its aggregation. In addition to that, it is very important to know that there are three quite different types of catalysis for the catalysis of solid-state heterochloroacetic. One is, this dark star represents primary particles, so solid. The first type is called, we call surface type. So it is a traditional or ordinary heterogeneous catalysis. Reaction takes place on the surface of primary particles. I mean the surface area measured by nitrogen absorption. And the second type we found is what we call pseudolytic type. Reactant molecule go into the lattice of the solid, expanding the lattice distance, that is absorption into the bulk, like water absorption into calcium chloride or something, and react to the end and come out. And later we find there are another type of bulk catalysis. Although the main reaction will proceed on the surface, proton and electrons go through the bulk, all the solid take part in reduction and oxidation of catalysis. So the reaction rate is proportional to the surface area in this case, and in those two cases, the reaction rate is not proportional to the surface area, but the volume of the solid. I'll show you the big difference between bulk and surface type catalysis. This is a case of bulk type catalysis or pseudolytic catalysis. when you neutralize heterochloroacetic by sodium progressively, the acidity and catalytic activity, for example, dehydration of alcohols, all of those inclines monotonically as the neutralization proceeds. But in the case of surface type catalysis, for example, neutralization of cesium and the reaction is the creation of aromatics or so, the catalytic activity decreases fast as the proton is replaced by cesium, but at certain point, the catalytic activity rises sharply, which is far higher than original acid. At first, this result surprised us, but later on it turned out this is not surprising. We plotted the catalytic activity against the number of protons on the surface. We found this is solid solution and proton cesium distributed uniformly throughout the bulk. So the number of protons can be calculated by the chemical formula and surface area. If you plot the catalytic activity against the number of protons on the surface, that's calculated. We found linear correlation. So the reason why we have very high catalytic activity of cesium 2.5 is that the primary particle is very fine and the surface area becomes very high. Not a very simple reason. When you neutralize completely and produce cesium 3, the surface area becomes still high, but there's no problem. The surface acidity is zero and the catalytic activity becomes zero. So this means the important point noted in this figure is activity per proton, that is the slope of this straight line, is much greater than the slope for those conventional solid acids. So the proton on the surface of the heterotopic line is very, very active for this kind of reaction. So further, it means that if you properly disperse heterochorion on a proper high surface area support, you will get very high catalytic activity. So we tried, actually, my former colleague tried that, and he measured the surface acidity by the absorption on benzonitrile. If you measure the acidity by ammonia, ammonia go in this heterochorion. In the case of ammonia, it goes into the bulb, so the surface acidity cannot be measured. All acidity is measured. So when you use benzonitrile, only the surface can be measured, and when you increase the amount of supported heterochorion acid on the silica, the surface acidity increases at first, but shows maximum at this area and goes down. If you have 100% heterochorion acid, the surface area is so small, the surface acid is very small. If you simply calculate the number of layers of the heterochorion acid on the surface, assuming uniform layer, this area corresponds to two layers, and this corresponds to five layers of heterochorion acid on the surface. Then we applied this speculation was confirmed by Ariane and experimental. At very low loading, you can see IR because of the low signal and partial decomposition. When you increase the amount of loaded before, you can see infrared characteristic of K-ion polyanion, and also you can see X-ray diffraction of bulk heterochorion acid. So it is very likely that heterochorion acid is dispersed on the surface. When the loading level is very low, it's on layer or ion. If you have this layer, you have three, four, five layers on the surface. If you go further, you get very thick layer or large crystal. We apply this catalyst to the alkylation, acidation of this compound. This is an important intermediate for pharmaceutical. As expected, heterochorion acid supported in the silica showed much higher activity than conventional. So now we apply those knowledge to improve the industrial process. The first example is the new process of ester acetate synthesis. This process was industrialized by Schwab in 1990 using heterochorion, but it showed the serious deactivation. So we try to improve. Finally, we succeeded in collaborating. We succeeded to dramatically improve heterochorion acid catalyst by joint research. I'll explain briefly what we have done. This reaction, usually, ester acetate is synthesized by using acetic acid and ether. For that reaction, ordinary solid acids are good enough. But for mention, sorry, because I'm not that, but we need this IP. So this company tried cesium 2.5, which we found very active, and this catalyst showed very highly close to the target value. And after several trials and errors, they found lithium salt of heteropolyl acid supporting the silica gel was active, and they industrialized using that catalyst. But in the real time, they found that the activation of the catalyst was serious, and they were almost stopping the plant. So we started collaboration to improve the catalyst. The improvements we have done together is first examination of the deactivation mechanism. The mechanism was rather simple. The main reason was the oligomerized ester, the butene, pentene, etc., which are recycled, which accelerated the deactivation of the catalyst. That ordinarily, usually found for the solid acetic acid catalyst. And in order to suppress the oligomerization that we do for the proteins, we try to improve the structure of supported heteropolyls, the appropriate thickness of heteropolyl acid on the surface. If the heteropolyl acid source loaded with so small, decomposition and a thin state and it caused undesired reaction. If the heteropolyl acid is very thick, the surface area decreases and the activity decreases. In addition to that, the reaction in the deep solid, that is pseudolytic phase reaction, tend to accelerate the polymerization. So we try to trial and errors, mainly try to make the pore size and the surface area appropriate. And we tried several kinds of supporting methods. And we found that the impurity was silica, like aluminum, iron, calcium, very bad, and caused aluminumization. We tried to decrease the impurity as much as possible. And the pore size, about 5 nanometer in monodispersed distribution were instilled. And in addition to this, additional steam in the feed was helpful. Operation conditions, particularly the very careful control of temperature was essential. I'll show you some examples of those we tried. This shows the presence of metallic impurity much affect the formation of the genes. By decreasing the amount of impurity, we are able to decrease the formation of butenes 120s. So to do that, the control of surface area and the pore size was important. I can read the proof already. Yeah. As for the addition of skin, at a certain point, we are able to suppress the yield of butenes without using much catalytic activity. As a result of those efforts, we are able to increase the catalyst life more than 2 years at 1.3 times higher productivity. So the first generation catalyst, this is a reaction temperature, and this means deactivation. The first generation catalyst deactivated rapidly, but now the improved catalyst still running and activity is quite acceptable. Now we compare briefly green, how green the improved process is as compared to the existing processes. unfortunately, this was missing because of the difference of the computer. As for the atomic efficiency, this is very good, this is so-so, and this is no good. And as for this very good, fair, no good. As for the safety, this is very good, this is not bad, this is not bad. As for the spent catalyst, this is very good, this is not very good, this is bad. So our new process, the improved process is very good. Now, we apply the same idea to improve another process. This is oxidation of ethylene, direct oxidation of ethylene to form acetic acid. In this case, palladium modified by kelvin combined with heterophthalic acid supported from silica gel was being used. We applied improvement in the same way as we did for the ethyl acetate process. And we are able to improve the catalyst life more than two times at a 50% better space-time yield. This is another example of the application of basic research in industrial processes. Let me go on and explain rapidly about perovskite catalyst. I think you are familiar with this kind of very popular mixed oxide. This has can be well catalyzed, lead for the solid structure. Our research may be summarized in these five principles. The selection of A, B, all three type mixed oxide. The selection of B is very important. Balance control of B is good to improve the catalyst. And the combination of two trans elements like this very helpful to increase oxidation activity and cyclicity. And a combination is novel. I'll show you one example for the application of those three principles, and later I'll explain and give even more detail about the planning terms called catalyst for automobile emission. This is our old application. Catalysts are located here, and where you use those equipment and smells and smoke coming out of those equipment can be almost eliminated by catalysts. And these catalysts are now very popular in Japan. The most of, those equipment are furnished with these catalysts. They are now using much better ones than what I found in Africa. Now let me go to the palladium perovskite catalyst. This was mainly done by this motor company in Japan, and they call this intelligent catalyst because the state of the catalyst can change, recognizing the change of the atmosphere of emission. The point is that you are able to have much longer catalyst life of this catalyst, and due to that, they were able to decrease the amount of palladium used 30% of the conventional catalyst. It's a saving of 70%. The catalyst is located very close to the engine, so they have to have time resistant to high temperature. The point is that, as I explained later, the palladium sweepers is located in the lattice of perovskite, oxidizing atmosphere. When the atmosphere change to reducing, it goes to palladium, zero nanopattern. And during the alternating atmosphere, radium goes into the, that is, in, back on the surface as the radium nanoparticle. So the small signs of radium can be kept for a long time. This shows how stable this radium perovskite as compared to conventional catalysts. This shows the XPS spectra of radium, and radium can be changed from radium 0 to more than 2 plus on plus upon reduction of station. It is to be noted, should be noted that this is almost plus 2. Plus 2 is the state of radium in perovskite. And this, I'm not familiar with this, but according to specialists, this shows the palladium is actually located in the lattice of perovskite when it is oxidized. This is called the X-ray anomalous diffraction. Keeping the angle at this position, the energy is swept for short range, and this gap show that palladium is located. Something different from cobalt ion is located in the place of in the place of ion and cobalt, palladium is located. This shows examples in Zenith. This also shows the last change between palladium nanoparticle and palladium ion in perovskite. And this is in situ measurement. And this result shows this is a result of Zenith. And this shows the transformation between palladium in the perovskite and palladium on the surface of the perovskite is very in a few seconds. It takes place. And finally, this process is some elastic in this figure. This is called self-regenerative function. And in conventional catalyst, a palladium located on the surface upon oxidation and reduction sink, forming a very large crystal of palladium like this. But in the case of catalyst, that is palladium perovskite catalyst, palladium located in solid power in the lattice. In apple, actually, it goes up on the surface as a nanoparticle palladium in an oxidizing atmosphere. As you know, the emission of an automobile alternate change in reversible between reducing and oxidizing atmosphere. It goes palladium on the surface, goes back into the lattice. So this is repeated. You will see the palladium size remains very small for a long time. This is the reason why the catalyst life is very long, and you do not need a large amount of palladium from the beginning. You can use a very small amount of palladium automobile catalyst. Now they are able to incorporate platinum and rhodium into the perovskite oxide, and they now expanding their sales and utilization in automobile in Japan, probably in other countries. So in summary, I would say what I showed you may be not very contribution, but real and fun contribution to the green catalytic technology, and then for the society. Heteroboric acid solids are promising for green processes, and perovskite and high potential. responsibility for environmental killers, particularly automobile killers. Thus, the catalysts are key technology for the sustainable society. Thank you very much for your attention.
Professor Isomo, excellent talk, and thank you very much. And you are well on time, so we have time for questions. Do we have questions from the audience? Here we have one from our co-chairman.
You mentioned two times that palladium in your catalyst exists in the level oxidation of 3+. What kind of evidence do we have for that?
I'm not sure whether it is three, just three, or 3+ or something. But I can say that the oxidation state is higher than 2 because of the experience. The shift is in the more oxidized state than plus 2, but less than plus 4. So it's likely that the oxidation is in between 2+ and 3+. And another evidence is that palladium is actually situated in the lattice of perovskite. To be there, where palladium must be in plus 3. Those two show that palladium is located in the lattice of perovskite in 3+.
But do you have some ESR spectra for this or no? Just, well, this is palladium, palladium,
diamond. So I don't think it's possible.
Ricardo, I have a question for you. The formula that you showed us was lanthanum, iron 0.57, cobalt 0.38, palladium 0.05, oxygen 3. Now, is there any significance to having the iron there and or cobalt for the regeneration or not?
Yeah, that is the composition of the first generation palladium perovskite catalyst. We chose the actual event that copper chose after many trial and errors. But basic knowledge to support that is we changed the ratio of iron cobalt from 0 to 1 to 1 to 0, and we try to see the thermal stability and catalytic activity. The thermal stability increases with increasing in cobalt, and the catalytic activity increases in the opposite direction. And so in the certain composition between two extremes, that should be optimal. And we thought that one was the best. But recently, cobalt is not good for environment. So we eliminated totally cobalt from perovskite. Now we use lanthanum iron also.
Lanthanum iron?
All three. Without cobalt, just iron. That was
no cobalt. And no nickel or magnesium or manganese.
No, nothing. So it's not very simple.
Let me see, do we have any other questions? Yes, there are quite a few out there.
Hello. So, thank you very much for excellent lecture. I have a question. So, in our studies of the palladium manganese systems and also the palladium perovskites, we observe in on the X-piece spectra, palladium reduces more than palladium zero. We see palladium delta plus. Do you have some evidence of this type of palladium in your system? Palladium, no. Palladium delta plus. Not zero, not palladium 1+, but palladium delta plus.
What I can say is palladium mostly very close to zero.
Yes, it's close to zero, but it's not zero.
I'm sure. I did we didn't take much care about the exact expectations. What I can say and what I should say, radium is very close to zero and it forms nanoparticles.
Thank you.
And good enough for the
community. We have two questions up in there.
Could you explain which mechanism stays behind the reversible diffusion of palladium ions from the lattice onto the surface?
You see, it is already known, and there is the process, the existence
mechanism.
Of the process.
Mechanism.
Mechanism.
Yes.
You agree that it happens.
Yes.
So there should be some mechanism. And actually, I think palladium go out of the surface.
Yes, but
being reduced and probably forms oxygen or cation vacancies, and at the same time we see nanomonoxide oxide in the sample of palladium peroxide. So it forms a solid state chemical reaction in the palladium lanthanum cobalt decomposes the palladium metal and the lanthanum ion cobalt oxide and lanthanum 2-oxide. That is.
That's far reduced.
It has to range to make an ordinary solid state reaction.
There's another question up in there somewhere. Maybe they change their mind. We have one over here. Over here.
Okay.
Yes.
I have a simple but practical question. You mentioned you want to lessen the cobalt content because of environmental reasons. Okay. If you don't lose cobalt, there is no environmental impact. Therefore, I conclude you lose cobalt. This would mean deactivation. How do you manage it?
In the main, main component that is responsible for catalytic activity is palladium nanoparticles. Over helps, probably, I'm sure, helps the reaction oxidation or some other oxidation. Cobalt is not essential for the reaction. Probably the sound stability and the easiness of the solid state reaction may be affected by the presence of different kinds of transition metals.
I'm sorry, but this was not the question. The question was, do you lose cobalt?
No.
No?
So,
then there is no environmental impact. You don't have to lessen the content of cobalt.
I agree. But some people are anxious about the presence of cobalt itself. Although I do not agree.
I agree with you. Ricardo, I have one more question for you. In your oxidation of ethylene to acetic acid, you have a palladium tellurium hetrochloric acid catalyst on silica. Mm-hmm. Is the latest composition that you have still containing tellurium or not? And do you have any problems with tellurium loss?
Good question. We have. I would say the company has.
You are in a good place. You always were able to
between the minefields. Try to.
So, time for one more question, but I think we have one. I guess not. It was so clear. Thank you very much.